software update was a crypto challenge from the 34th C3 CTF, where you had a signed firmware update and your goal was it to find a flaw in the update process that would allow you to somehow exploit the process. In this first part, I would like to go over the source code and tell you about the thoughts and weird ideas we had and how we approached this challenge. The actual solution shows what a blockhead I am, and quite embarrassingly involved some fairly simple math that I should have known, but my intuition was completely off. I would like to explain the solution in a bit more detail because it kind of blew my mind. It's an awesome practical example of what's usually abstract math. Anyway, let's head in. Software update. In the end, 23 teams solved it. Always remember to keep your router firmware up to date. Connect with Telnet to port 2023. And files to download. Difficulty, easy, mid. When you connect via Telnet, you are presented with a proof of work request. This is not part of the challenge and can be ignored. It's just a way to rate limit the actual challenge server so people can't easily DOS it, like a captcha. You can download the Python script, call it like that, and then wait for a few seconds or minutes, depending on how powerful your machine is. Then enter the proof of work solution. Now you have access to the actual challenge. Welcome to Super Secure Router Limited's Super Secure Router Telnet interface. You can upload a software update here. This is where the actual challenge starts. In the downloaded source code, you can find a challenge.py file that contains this part. You can see that it loads a public key from somewhere and then expects an input, which is then Base64 decoded and then saved as a temporary file. So basically, it expects a firmware update as a Base64 encoded zip file string. Then it will call verify and install software update from the installer module with the zip file path and the public key. In there, it will check the size of the zip file, if okay, read the information of all the files in the zip, then looping over this information and check for each file the file size. If everything is safe here as well, it will unpack the zip into a temporary directory and call check signature. And if the signature check was valid, it will call do install. One example firmware update zip was also provided. If we unpack it, we find the following directory structure. A signature as well as signed data folder with a post and pre-copy script, some patch notes and a new file /bin. If you look into do install, we can see how the actual firmware update works. First, the precopy.py script in the firmware update is executed, then all the files are copied into the root of the file system, so the some router stuff would be copied into /bin, and then the postcopy script is executed. But the install only happens if the check signature call was successful. Let's see what's going on there. This function will call compute hash on the unpacked firmware zip. Then the signature file inside the firmware image is read. Then this hash is checked against the signature with PKCS1PSS, which is a signature scheme based on RSA. And the public key used is also known to us. But we obviously don't have the private key, so we can't generate a valid signature for any arbitrary other hash. Next, let's have a look at the compute hash function. This one gets all files and folder paths with glob and then loops over all of them. If the path was a file, it will create a SHA-256 hash from the file path, a null byte separator, and the file content. If it was only a directory, a slash is appended to the path and then SHA-256 hash is created with an additional null byte at the end. The resulting hash is then XORed with the previous hash round. So all those hashes generated from files and folders are XORed together. And the final XOR result is then what is returned by this function compute hash and checked if it matches the signature signed with the private key that matches the public key we know. Let's try this out. When we connect via Netcat to the port, I first have to execute the proof of work script and then I can send over the Base64 encoded zip file. So I can do cat software update.zip and pipe it into Base64. Be careful, some Base64 tools add new lines, but on Mac it's default just one long line. Then I can also pipe it into pbcopy on Mac, which places it into the clipboard. So now I can just paste it into the Netcat session. But some kind of buffering of my terminal is effed up, so it always stops. No clue how to fix that. To get around that, I can do it this way. I can first do a cut dash, which simply echoes whatever I enter. Because first I want to enter the proof of work solution. And then I want to cut the software update and base64 encode it and pipe it into the input of the Netcat session. So I place both commands into parentheses and pipe both into Netcat. So the first command executed is the cat dash, so I can simply execute the PowerScript and send the solution. Now to stop cat dash, I can press Ctrl D, which will indicate an end of transmission, and cat dash terminates. Next, the cat of the software update zip is executed, which is base64 encoded and then piped into Netcat. This will apply the update, but we get an error. Preparing to copy data. Processing your update. There was an error installing the update. Permission denied for bin some router stuff. But based on this output, we can also see that it mostly worked. Preparing to copy data was printed by the execution of the pre-copy script from inside our zip. And the permission denied was likely caused by the attempt to copy the files into the file system root, which means the copy tree call failed and post-copy was never executed. This might seem odd, but it's fine. It probably means that the actual update, replacing and copying new files, is not really part of the challenge. And the pre-copy script was executed, so if we could control that one, we could have code execution. But where's the vulnerability here? So we knew it was a crypto challenge, so we of course thought we had to focus on the crypto part, which is the hashes and the signature verification. We spent quite some time looking for weaknesses in the RSA signature scheme. For example, we checked if the RSA public key was weak, but the public exponent was large and the modulus we can extract from the key had no entry on FactoryDB and was really large too. So brute forcing was not realistic. We also tried to look for crypto papers on this topic, because sometimes there are weak edge cases that could happen, but the signature scheme looked pretty solid. So after a lot of time spent on this research, we explored other ideas. In the doInstall function, we also noticed the symlinks flag, which we thought was odd. So we were wondering if we could do anything with symlinks. The SIP file format standard does support symlinks, so maybe we could symlink something that could result in a RCE or maybe overwrite some important system files after a copy. But the copy was also the part that failed, and we still probably had to figure out how to break the hashing and signature verification to get a symlink into it in the first place. But we were still trying to come up with creative ideas, so it seemed like a valid path to investigate. To play around with this, we can write a simple Python script that uses the functions of the installer to test the verification locally. You have to make sure to get all the dependencies installed like PyCrypto, but then we can add debug prints in various places. So I added a print in each condition for file, directory, or else. If you run the script now, you can see all the files that are being hashed. Now let's add a symlink, for example, to /etc/passwd. You can see that it's recognized as a file and verification fails. But while playing around with that, we noticed a few interesting things. First, when the symlink did not point to a valid file, it would not be recognized as a file, which means no hash is calculated for it. And I thought we could maybe combine that with the file copy part. We could let the symlink point to a non-existing file, then the verification succeeds, and then the copy tree happens that could fix the symlink to point to a valid file. Not sure where that would get us, but it sounded like a creative idea. But then we noticed verification fails, even though the invalid symlink didn't get hashed. This uncovered another small bug. The hash of the previous loop iteration is XORed again, which means the previous hash cancelled itself out. Which means with a second invalid symlink, the hash is XORed a third time, restoring the original valid value. We really thought we were onto something here, because this bug would allow us to create any other file in the firmware update and cancel the XOR hash with an invalid symlink. We didn't really know what we could do with arbitrary files, but we can figure that out in another step. So we wanted to try that. But then we quickly realized that Python zip file extraction doesn't care about symlinks. It will not unpack them. So symlinks won't work. Oh man. But still, with this XOR cancel out bug, I really thought it would be the trick, and I looked up other supported types in zip files. I read something about device nodes, but it all led nowhere. And the fact that it's supposed to be a crypto challenge also kept bugging me. One other thought somebody had was, what if we somehow can control the hashes or the XOR result? But controlling the hashes is unlikely, because there are no known SHA-256 collisions or similar attacks. And then I was thinking, how could we control the XORs if we can't even control the SHA-256 hashes? But still, I was googling a bit about XORing hashes and their cryptographic and randomness properties. But it didn't lead much to anything. Hashes are random data, and the intuition I had also told me this is not possible. The only thing I could think of and what else I found online was that the same hash would cancel itself out again. And so one last idea I tried to think about was if we somehow can get two files to generate the same hash. The hash of a file is generated by the file path and the content. So the basic idea I had was if we could move parts of the file path into the file, then we could have two different files, but it would result in the same hash. Let's ignore the null byte for a second. For example, a file with the name ABC would have the same hash as a file with the name A and the content BC. But this doesn't work because of the null byte. You can't get a null byte into the file path. So while I thought the idea was clever, it just didn't work out. So you can see we really tried a lot of different things. But luckily, some other team members were a bit more persistent and had a better mathematical intuition than I had. The trick here was, in fact, exploiting the XORing of the hashes. And it was actually fairly simple math that I should have known. But for some reason, I just didn't realize that we are looking at it as a simple math problem. It really blew my mind. But I want to dedicate its own episode about the math in detail. So, see you next time.